and in some years you might get zero water. So they said nobody could take any more water, so you're going to have to find a way to share water.
Mike Young is the founding father of the Australian water markets. A renowned economist, he attended Harvard University and has advised the United Nations. This is the man writing the new history of water.
Water scarcity is really there. So water scarcity is part of the future of the world. The global predictions are that by 2050, more than half the world will be living with limited water resources, and abundance is a thing of the past. Water needs to be managed in a very precious way. In a way that drives innovation, that makes sure our water goes to the best use as it possibly can, so we make money and feed ourselves well. And that led to the interest in water markets and drove a revolution.
The revolution started by Mike Young has turned climate imbalance into a market force.
It's fascinating to see how sophisticated our water markets have become. If there's rain forecast in a week's time, the price of water will go down because farmers know they won't have to irrigate. If it's going to be really hot for the next fortnight, then the price of water goes up.
Mike Young has opened up water markets to all: farmers, municipalities, small investors, and above all, professional traders. Nowadays, everybody can buy water on the stock market for consumption or simply as a vehicle for speculation.
When water becomes scarce, and as it becomes scarcer, then somebody has to stop using it. And what markets do is they discover and reveal the most appropriate people to pull out of agriculture. As it is for making cars, as it is for lots of things, we live in a competitive world.
Australia's new Lords of Water live in Melbourne, one of the country's business centres. They are bankers, insurers, pension and investment fund managers, and they are gradually taking control of this blue gold.
I don't need to own land. You know, would I own land? Would I consider it? Yes, but I'm not a farmer. I'm an investment banker.
How much did you invest?
Not much, maybe $20 million. The price of water has doubled, but in the next 10 years it will double again, because of intensive agriculture.
Nicknamed the Water Bandit, David Williams rules over his empire from the 45th floor of an office tower. As an owner of expansive water reserves, he rents his water to farmers, as others would rent land. And his future looks bright.
If we go to 9 billion population and the Chinese want more food and the Indonesians want more food and the Indians want more food and they can afford to pay for it, then we need to find more intensive ways of growing food. That means more water. And that's going to lead you smack bang into how you get that water, how you price it, how you allocate it, and how you regulate it.
With the big investors buying water, it's getting back to the old days of the landlords and the peasant farmers. And if we want to survive or stay into it, we're going to have to buy the water at what the landlords deem the water is worth. Back to the Middle Ages, yeah.
Water was the last remaining natural resource to have escaped trading. But Australia has pulled the plug on that exemption, because water offers an opportunity for greater profitability and wealth.
If you thought the hot weather was bad this weekend, just wait until tomorrow. The fifth day of our heat wave is expected to be incredibly uncomfortable and potentially dangerous as the humidity...
It's very, very hot today. It's moving in from the Midwest, where they've been dealing with this sweltering heat. And now that it's moving here to the East Coast, it could stick around for several days, becoming a full-blown heat wave.
Make water a commodity. List it on the stock exchange. Bet on its price. What if Wall Street copied the Australian model? Ever since the subprime mortgage crisis, when bundles of bad debt destroyed lives and countries, finance giants have been looking for new investment opportunities. In June 2008, the investment bank Goldman Sachs began wondering, is water the new oil? The firm, as the bank is known, encourages top clients to take a gamble on the future.
Goldman Sachs, the conference, that was me. I used to work at Goldman Sachs, and in 2008, that was a conference that I held. There's this absolute intuitive appeal that says population growth is outstripping the water supply. That must mean companies that are engaging in the water business are a sure thing, that they can't miss. They get mesmerized by these megatrend appeals in water. Is water the next oil? That question's not going to go away. We're just probably not ready for it yet.
In the developed world, for the last 100 years, we haven't had to think about our water or worry about our water. It's been essentially unlimited, wherever we want it, whenever we want it. It's been really inexpensive. No one thinks about their water bill. They don't say, oh, take a shorter shower, the water's too expensive. I think that era is over. Climate change is going to have a huge impact on water availability around the world. The same amount of water is going to be available in the big picture, but we don't live in the big picture. We live in a specific place. We raise our food in a specific place, and so the movement of that water will have a dramatic impact on how cities manage their water and how we're able to grow food to feed everybody.
The climate emergency demands radical changes. When it comes to water, Wall Street is poised for a takeover. In a 2017 report, Citigroup, one of the largest U.S. banks, announced the end of free and cheap water.
There is no alternative to pricing water properly and making people realize that every time they take a sip of water, there is an opportunity cost, and they feel it in their wallet. How else are you going to get people to use less if you give it to them for free?
The dam has broken. Liberalism celebrates free markets. Its proponents are pushing ahead with plans for a union of finance and water.
We are going to see asset markets selling water derivatives. Even the high-frequency traders, the hedge funds, would become interested. So no, everybody sees this as an opportunity that will come. The question is just when and who will push it first and hardest.
And what would be their motivation in coming?
Profits. While also, indirectly doing good for humanity. So it's the best of all possible worlds. What could be better?
But isn't it very immoral to trade water?
Why would it be immoral to trade water?
Because water is life.
We pay for healthcare. Just because it's life doesn't mean it cannot be priced.
A decisive step in the commodification of water happened in December 2020, when Wall Street began trading water futures. The futures are tied to the NASDAQ Velez California Water Index, which is based on prices in the state's major river basins. An algorithm provides a benchmark price for water transactions across California. It's the first time that water has been reduced to an algorithm. The man who came up with the equation works in the city of London. Before he discovered water, the former Swiss bank trader was involved in the carbon market, the trade in greenhouse gas emission permits.
Water used to be free in the old world, but the world is changing. There's too much stress on the system, and the most important commodity on earth can't be free forever. If you wanted to put it into the greed scenario, if you don't control it and use it properly, what will theoretically happen is those with the cash will have it, and those without the cash won't have it. If what people are saying is coming, you better be on top of your water situation, or you're going to be without water. And what I'm doing is getting people's focus through financial instruments to see what is actually going on the ground. It changes the world of water.
Is it too late to stop a financial takeover of water?
We're just at the beginning of this water revolution, the water financial revolution.
You can't let the market be the only decider of how water's allocated. Price can't be the only way you distribute water, because then you'll have rich people with big swimming pools and poor people who are dead.
The global water rush is accelerating. Privatization, competition, profit. Key words from the doctrine of classical liberalism. One woman is standing up to the threat of water's commodification. Canadian human rights activist Maud Barlow. She won her first victory at the United Nations in 2010, when the General Assembly voted in favor of a resolution that recognized access to water as a universal right.
It must be declared a public resource that belongs equally to
all. I was in the United Nations up in the balcony the day that they voted, and I thought we were going to lose. I had staff with me. They were crying. I said, don't worry. We're going to be back in 2 years or 5 years, no matter how long it takes. We're going to be back, and we'll do it. And when they vote, they sit in their chairs, and they vote electronically, so you know right away. So boom, 122 countries voted in favor, and 41, they abstained. They didn't have the nerve to oppose, even though they actually wanted to oppose.
Among the nations that abstained that day were Australia, the United States, and Britain. Countries that have all opted to turn water into a financial product.
The human family took an evolutionary step forward at that point. And since then, every country has ratified. It's in one way or another, it's now universal.
So you got it now.
You got it now.
Maud Barlow won that battle, but she hasn't yet won the war against the commodification of water. In December 2018, the activist was invited by the Nobel Committee to a conference on the future of water in Stockholm.
The United Nations calls water scarcity the scourge of the earth. To truly guarantee the human right to water, we must protect it as a public trust and a commons, not a commodity to be put on the open market for sale like oil and gas.
and we must challenge the current power structures and institutions that support unequal access to the planet's dwindling water supplies. Our goal must be clean, affordable, accessible, public water for all, for everywhere, for all time.
Is it the end of cheap and free water?
Well, the corporations and Citigroup and others want it to be the end of free and cheap water. That's their argument. They're saying, oh yes, it's a human right, because they can't fight that anymore because everybody says you're an awful person if you deny it, right? So, oh yes, it's a human right, but the end of free and cheap water. When they say it's got to be a commodity, it's because they know that the scarcer it becomes in a world where you desperately need water, there's gold. It's gold. It's blue gold.
The winds of revolt are strengthening. In Europe, the fight against the commodification of water is above all reflected in public opposition to privatization moves. Citizens spearheading the resistance have taken to the streets of Dublin, Rome, Berlin, and Paris. But how long will Europe be able to withstand pressure from the financial world? In 2012, a petition called Right to Water amassed nearly 2 million signatures. The petition demanded that the human right to water and sanitation be written into European law.
The European Citizens Initiative really changed the way we discuss about water in Europe. It helped creating a movement and a whole idea that water should be considered as a human right. Before, all the documents from the European Commission were starting to introduce market mechanisms. They were always pushing for liberalization. Now, this is not something that you can easily do in a public way. So the official answer from the European Commission was, of course, we support the human right to water, but nothing happened. No, in real, in legislation.
The Right to Water petition has succeeded in halting the ambitions of financiers across Europe. But it remains a fragile victory.
There are two paths, and I don't know who's going to win this. It's either water is a commodity and it's going to be put on the open market for sale, or it's not. It's going to be understood to be a human right. You can't have it both ways. It's time to choose now which path.
A word on hope from each of you, please.
Well, for me, the hope is...
But the world's a different place, and it's changing. Changing fast.
Water scarcity and climate change, is it a windfall for our business? Yes, it is. Is that a bad thing? Well, I suppose time will tell.
I'd be saying don't do it. Don't take on this model. People just trying to make huge amount of money out of it. You're more or less gonna have to sell your soul to get the water to be able to survive.
The fate of water on our planet hangs in the balance. More than 4 billion years ago, it arrived on this Earth from space and has since survived all manner of catastrophes. But it is now being threatened by people who dream of turning rivers into gold. As if nature was nothing but a giant supermarket.
Well, you can see that the behavior of the financial elites around the world from Australia to Wall Street is raising considerable alarm about the future of water all over the world. Why? Well, simply put, it's because people like these, Mike Young, an economist at the University of Adelaide, have come up with models for how to use the market to regulate access to water. And various people in the capital markets field have begun to see this as an opportunity for making considerable amounts of money. David Williams, a banker, has become known as the robber baron of water in and around Adelaide. And Wilhelm Buiter, an economist, has provided the rationale for this from the point of view of a financial investor. Lance Coogan has in fact set up a firm called Velus Water. He's the CEO of it, creating financial instruments to extend the financialization of water as a commodity. But others like Charles Fishman have had reservations and point to the dangers of financializing water as an asset to be sold on stock markets. Deutsche Welle has done a very good study, short documentary available on the web called Lords of Water. And it's raised the question, among other things, of, by design or default, which populations are not among the Lords of Water. Let's listen for a second to Wilhelm Buiter's assessment of the circumstance we now face, not just in Adelaide, not just in Australia, but now globally.
Is it too late to stop a financial takeover of water?
We're just at the beginning of this water revolution, the water financial revolution. There is no alternative to pricing water properly and making people realize that every time they take a sip of water, there is an opportunity cost, and they feel it in their wallet. How else are you going to get people to use less if you give it to them for free?
The dam has broken. Liberalism celebrates free markets. Its proponents are pushing ahead with plans for a union of finance and water.
We are going to see asset markets selling water derivatives. Even the high-frequency traders, the hedge funds, would become interested. So no, everybody sees this as an opportunity that will come. The question is just when and who will push it first and hardest.
And what would be their motivation in coming?
Profits. While also, indirectly doing good for humanity. So it's the best of all possible worlds. What could be better?
But isn't it very immoral to trade water?
Why would it be immoral to trade water?
Because water is life.
We pay for healthcare. Just because it's life doesn't mean it cannot be priced.
Liberalism celebrates free markets. Its proponents are pushing ahead with plans for a union of finance and water.
We are going to see asset markets selling water derivatives. Even the high-frequency traders, the hedge funds, would become interested. So no, everybody sees this as an opportunity that will come. The question is just when and who will push it first and hardest.
And what would be their motivation in coming?
Profits. While also, indirectly doing good for humanity. So it's the best of all possible worlds. What could be better?
Well, that's a pretty succinct statement the financial investor's point of view about water as an asset. Charles Fishman had a slightly different perspective on this. He too, as an author of a book called The Big Thirst, emphasizes that water is becoming more and more an object that has to be regulated in some way. But he notes that the pricing of water may not be a final solution.
You can't let the market be the only decider of how water's allocated. Price can't be the only way you distribute water, because then you'll have rich people with big swimming pools and poor people who are dead.
The global water rush is accelerating. Privatization, competition, profit. Key words from the doctrine of classical liberalism. One woman is standing up to the threat of water's commodification. Canadian human rights activist Maude Barlow. She won her first victory at the United Nations in 2010, when the General Assembly voted in favor of a resolution that recognized access to water as a universal right.
Earth and all species alike. It must be declared a public resource that belongs equally to
all. I was in the United Nations, up in the balcony, the day that they voted, and I thought we were going to lose. I had staff with me. They were crying. I said, don't worry. We're going to be back in 2 years or 5 years, no matter how long it takes. We're going to be back, and we'll do it. And when they vote, they sit in their chairs, and they vote electronically, so you know right away. So boom, 122 countries voted in favor, and 41, they abstained. They didn't have the nerve to oppose, even though they actually wanted to oppose.
Among the nations that abstained that day were Australia, the United States, and Britain. Countries that have all opted to turn water into a financial product.
The question becomes, which of these perspectives will dominate the minds of the new lords of water, as they are being called, around the world? Not just in Australia, but around the world. Because Wall Street has taken an interest in the models that have been developed in Australia for regulating access to water through the mechanisms of pricing it. It raises the age-old question of necessity versus commodity. If water becomes an asset market investment, and there are sales of it and its futures on asset markets, with capital being mobilized very quickly in hedge funds to speculate on its value, water becomes something very different than just an object of necessity. What about those who are not at the table when crucial decisions are made by these lords of water? Well, in many respects, this is the kind of thing that Vandana Shiva talked about 21 years ago in Vancouver. Let's recall what she said.
We are at the very center of what is going to happen.
About whether the commercial market logic of global corporations will work, or whether the earth logic of the sustenance of life, including our lives, will work.
Liberalism celebrates free markets. Its proponents are pushing ahead with plans for a union of finance and water.
We are going to see asset markets selling water derivatives. Even the high-frequency traders, the hedge funds, would become interested. So no, everybody sees this as an opportunity that will come. The question is just when and who will push it first and hardest.
And what would be their motivation in coming?
Profits, while also, indirectly doing good for humanity. So it's the best of all possible worlds. What could be better?
You can't let the market be the only decider of how water's allocated. Price can't be the only way you distribute water, because then you'll have rich people with big swimming pools and poor people who are dead.
What happens if prices and markets become the dominant means of allocating water on this blue planet? Is this just? Is it sustainable? Yes, we can say we're moving towards sustainability with the capture of solar energy. But what about the way in which we're treating water?
Thank you.